Let me begin by saying what an honor it is to be with you, and you've had a full day. I think in HR sometimes we get really locked into the systems. I want to start with a gratitude. Esther and Ritu, could you come up for just a moment? Come on up, come on up. Esther is the architect of this program, and Ritu is the builder. And there's a wonderful movie called Beautiful Mind that you may have seen. I don't know if you've seen it. It shows how old I am. The symbol of respect for those who give is a pen. So I would like to give both Esther and Ritu a nice pen as a symbol of gratitude for their service today. Who? By the way, we should just play music and that's the end of the session. I am honored to work with them and to be their partner. Who remembers the theme for this day? Fresh eyes. Rethink what's possible. I'm going to model that. I've got 45 slides, and I'm not going to use any of them. You can get access to the slides with Esther and Ritu, and you can get the slides. I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to be refreshed. By the way, that's a little risky. Esther, how long ago did we decide to do that? 3 minutes ago. By the way, I'm not uncomfortable with that. So here's what I'm going to ask of you. Find some place to take notes. You've got one sheet of paper that you can use. You've got a laptop. You've got a phone. I'm going to give you some headlines of what I think HR 3.0 is about. When we walk out of here in 30 to 40 minutes, I want you to say, those are some messages I'm going to think about. So I'm going to give you 10, 9 headlines, and you can create your own. You'll have the slides. They're beautiful slides. Assume that each of these headlines are beautifully slide-driven. But that's not my goal. I don't want you to read slides. I want you to think with me. Headline number one, context is the kingdom. Content is the king or the queen. The context where we live and work, the challenges of our decade, COVID, political toxicity, social efforts, technology, the technology that drives this conference, uncertainty in the world, that's the context, that's the kingdom. Content is how we respond. That's the king, that's the queen. Our job in HR is to create content. Context is the kingdom. Content is the king or the queen. Think outside in. That's number one. Number two, by the way, it's fun to make up a talk. HR is not about HR. You've heard that. You just heard that with Connor, with Peckham, with Awe. HR is not about HR. HR is about creating value in the marketplace. If we do not succeed in the marketplace, there is no workplace. A few years ago, when employee experience became a hot topic, I looked at the books and the articles, and everybody was excited about employee experience. Nobody was connecting employee experience with customer experience. If you don't have a marketplace with customers and investors, you don't have a workplace. HR is not about HR. It's about creating success in the marketplace. There's value of our values. We have a company with values. Peckham talked about that. Connor talked about that. Others have. If those values do not create value for our customer, they're not very efficacious. They're not helpful. Number one, context is the kingdom. Content is queen. Number two, HR is not about HR. It's about creating value in the marketplace. Number three, we create value through human capability. And the underlying word there is human capability. That's the next phase of HR. Human is the individual. Peckham talked about the three C's for the individual. The caring for people, the empathy for people, caring for people. Capability is the organization. Leadership is the combination. So number three is we contribute talent, leadership, and organization. That's what we contribute in this new world. And I'm going to get you all to remember it. So I'm going to make myself do something stupid with you. Raise your hand with fingers. That's talent. Look at your fingers. Maybe you don't like one. You could put it down. But that's your fingers. That's your talent. Even the dignified gentleman in the front row, raise your hand. Look stupid. There you go. Thank you. Your fist is the organization. That's the team. The fingers come together. This, in China, is respect. It's leadership. The forearms represent the HR systems. So you've got talent, organization, and leadership, and HR systems. And here's the stupid. Do the HR wave. Okay, that was so cool. There's a couple of dignified people in the audience that didn't look stupid. So now, number one, context is the kingdom. Content is the king or queen. Number two, HR is not about HR. It's success in the marketplace. Number three, by contributing talent, organization, and leadership, and doing the wave. What does that mean? I'm in a meeting. By the way, I hope you'll look at the slides because I have such pride about a couple of these slides. My business leader is talking about innovation. My business leader is talking about technology disruption. My business leader is talking about strategic change. What do I in HR contribute to that discussion? Think of this stupid thing. Do we have the right people with the right skills? Do we have the right organization with the right culture? And do we have the right leadership? That's it. I went through this conference, and you'll see it on one of my slides. I'm tempted to show one slide, but I'm going to do this without slides. I looked at every session. Every session in this great conference talked either about talent, the workforce of the future, what people need to know and do, what the experience is, organization, agility, hybrid, and leadership, the frameworks for leadership. I beg us, when we sit with our business leaders, do we have the right people, organization, and leadership? Number three. Number four, our people are our customers' most important asset. Let me say that again. We've all heard for decades, our people are our most important asset. I think it's incomplete and in some ways wrong. Our people are our customers' most important asset. Are we hiring, training, paying our people so that customers will have a better experience? That's the outside-in logic that goes back to number one and two. If we aren't hiring people our customers are delighted with, we're hiring the wrong people. Training programs, I could give examples. Staffing programs, are we involving our customers and our investors so that our people are our customers' and investors' most important asset? There's so many great stories about this. In a number of companies we've worked with, when we do train, how many of you work in the training area, leadership? Are 10 to 20% of the people who attend from outside your company? Customers, investors, community leaders, partners? Interesting question. How many work in the talent acquisition area? Have we involved customers and investors in defining the skills they want to see in our employees? Are we including them in the interviews and screening process? Our people are our customers' and investors' most important asset, number four. Number five, culture is not your values. Culture is a hot topic. We want to build the right culture, the right organization, the right fist. What are my values? No. Culture is how your values create value for your customer. Culture is not the roots of the tree, it's the leaves of the tree. Culture is what do I want to be known for in the marketplace? I'm a healthcare system in the master's class. We in Australia want to be known for great patient care, great quality. Good. That then, identity in the marketplace becomes the identity and culture of our company. If our external identity is not our culture, then we're schizophrenic. We're promising the customer A, B, and C, and we're training and doing a culture of D, E, and F. If you're trying to build the right organizational culture, go to marketing. What is it we're trying to be known for in our social media, in our advertising? Culture starts outside in, what we're known for in the marketplace. There's a lot of stories I could tell about that. I'm going to get the ideas out, then we'll get into questions. That's number five. Number six, the job of a leader is to make others feel better. Do we as HR people coach our leaders so that they walk away from an interaction with you feeling better or worse about themselves? How many here have met with Esther, either in person or in other settings? What percent of time do you walk away from an interaction, short, long, etc., not interminable, they don't want those, but a quick interaction, how many of you leave feeling better about yourself? By the way, Esther, you can't see it. Nobody's raising their hand. This is a problem. By the way, I have never had an interaction with Esther where I didn't leave feeling better about myself. Are you sitting by somebody you know? Look at them and say, are they a leader? Do they cause me to feel better about myself when I interact with them? As HR people, that's our job. We help our leaders lead by their making others feel better. Sometimes that's easy because we compliment people. Esther, great conference. Sometimes it's tough when you have to give difficult feedback. I'm going to pick up on what Peck Kim said. I'm coaching a leader, big company, global company, very tough company. I won't name the company. And an employee made a horrible mistake that's going to cost the company a lot of money. This leader said, I'm going to send a note because I'm going to hold that employee accountable. You made a horrible mistake. It's going to cost us a lot of money. And if you do it again, you'll be fired. Ooh. Will that employee feel better about himself? No. So I said to the person I was coaching, let me change three sentences. Number one, I care about you. Number two, you have a great future at this company. And you made a huge mistake. It's going to cost us a lot of money. Then number three, let's learn from the mistake so that you can improve. Notice you don't walk away as a leader from the challenge of leadership, holding people accountable. I love what Peck Kim just said around C's, collaborate, connect, and care. When leaders leave an interaction making the other person feel better about themselves, they lead. Now, let me take you back through the six things I've covered. Number one, context is the kingdom, content is the king or queen. Think outside in, adapt to the world we live in. Number two, it's so cool to do this impromptu. HR is not about HR. HR is about creating success in the marketplace. The values we have should create value for our customers. If we're not creating success in the marketplace, there is no workplace. Think outside in. Number three, we create success by contributing talent, organization, and leadership. And we do the wave. In talent, our people become our customers' most important asset. In organization, culture is the identity of, it's number five, culture is the identity of the firm in the mind of our key customers. Number six is leadership. The job of a leader is to help those who interact with the leader feel better about themselves. Number seven, the key to a successful HR department is the relationship we have with each other. How many of you are sitting by somebody in your HR department? How many are sitting by somebody? Look at the people you're sitting by. Do you have a positive relationship with them? By the way, I heard in the voice, some of you are guffawing, you're laughing. The key to a great HR department, based on our research, is not your structure, it's not your role clarity, it's the relationships you have with each other. Are we in HR forging those relationships? Are we listening to each other? Are we having a common purpose? Are we expressing what's right, not what's wrong? Are we responding to bids? Are we building relationships within the department? When we do that, we then build relationships with our business leaders, with our employees, with our customers outside, with our investors. The key to a great HR department is not the structure, it's the relationships. It's not role clarity, it's relationships. Number 8, and I'm almost done. The competencies of HR people are verbs, not nouns. We've studied HR competencies for a long time. Verbs more than nouns. Business partner, change agent, cultural steward. Notice every one of those: partner, agent, steward, employee, champion. They're nouns with an adjective. Now we've discovered we should focus on verbs. Verbs are not the role we play, but the actions we take. So number 8, what are the verbs of great HR? We've identified 5. 8 A, B, C, D, and E. A, we accelerate the business. I don't care where you work in HR. You could be a comp specialist, a talent specialist, a training specialist, a service center person. Number A, 8A, do you accelerate business results? Do you help your company succeed in the marketplace? B, we advance human capability. Advance, we move talent, organization, leadership forward. That's the theme of this brilliant conference. Fresh start. Try something new. Do a talk with no overheads. Explore the possibilities. Advance human capability. Number 3, we mobilize information. We mobilize information. I love the idea we act with common sense, that Peck Kim just said, but I'd compliment that, and at the same time, we bring evidence to bear. HR is a field of evidence. We're a field of data. We shouldn't be afraid of that information. We should mobilize it. D, we foster collaboration. We build relationships. We work together. And E, we simplify complexity. I'm not sure I'm doing that with 9 points, but I'm not showing you 40 slides. We simplify complexity. I like Peck Kim's line. It's common sense. I like what Connor said. Make it simple. Do you have an idea? Do it. Number 8, HR competencies are about verbs, not nouns. And number 9 ties back to this conference. This is a technology conference. How many sometimes feel overwhelmed with all the technology innovation? How many are turning to their kids to learn what it means? Let me give you my simple definition of technology. Technology provides digital information. AI, it's digital information. Avatar, it's digital information. Technology is a source of digital information to inform choice. Has anybody been to Disney World in the last 2 years? Did you get a band? Yeah, why? Disney wants to know a lot about you. You were at Disney. They know what time you leave the room. They know where you shop. They know the food you eat. They know the clothes you buy. I wonder if they'll use that. Duh. Amazon is an information company. Google. Technology enables digital information. That's number 9. The purpose of this conference is to get digital information on talent, organization, and leadership to make better decisions. And technology will change the way we do that in a very positive way. In HR, we use technology to do 2 things: to facilitate business transformation. My business is using digital information to transform itself in healthcare, in manufacturing, in service delivery. And 9B, we use digital information to upgrade HR, to get our HR services better. Whew. I've given you 9 nuggets. Where's HR headed? Let me go through the 9 again, and I'm going to have you think about those for a minute, and then I'll give you the 10th. Context is the kingdom, content is the king. Think outside in. If we can't change our company as fast as the context is changing, we won't have a company to change. Number two, HR is not about HR. It's about helping our company succeed in the marketplace. If we don't succeed in the marketplace, there is no workplace. Number three, HR delivers talent, organization, and leadership. Okay, I'm going to do a little test on three I didn't do. Hold up your fingers, that's talent. Hold up your fist, that's organization. Which one matters most as I try to help my company succeed in the marketplace? Is it, hold up one or the other, talent or leadership? Which one matters most? Talent? By the way, some of you are doing leadership. Is it talent or organization? You got to pick one or the other. Talent or organization? Fingers or fist? I see a fist, I see a yawn, I see a fist. By the way, the yawn is great feedback. I'm going to be done soon. Look around the people. I'm seeing a little more talent. Somebody's holding up both. You're a professor somewhere. It all depends. Here's the research. 4-1. 4-1. Organization. You fight a war with people. You win a war with organization. When I sit down with my business team, do we have the right talent? Do we have the right organization? Do we have the right leadership? Talent is number four. Are we getting talent our customers would value? Number five is organization, culture. Are we creating a culture inside the company tied to the promises we made to our customers? By the way, as soon as I say that, I think, wow, I've seen a lot of value statements. If your company has a value statement, take it to your customer. Number one, are these the values you want us to have? I was working with a company. Their number one value in their value statement, we want to be the most profitable firm in our industry. Let's go to a customer. Hey, our job is to be the most profitable firm in our industry. What do you think? And the customer said, I think I'll work with someone else. What a stupid value. Number five, create values inside that deliver value to your customer. Begin culture from the outside in. Number six, leadership. Our job as leaders is to help somebody feel better about themselves. By the way, I've been using that as a personal test for those who follow me, and I hope you will, and I hope you'll comment. Have any of you commented on any of my LinkedIn posts? I hope I've responded to your comments. I try to respond, and a year and a half ago, I was getting snarky. People said, sometimes on LinkedIn, people say stupid things. Write that down. And they have fake names. Peter Drucker has told me a lot of stupid things. I don't think it's the real Peter Drucker. I'm now having to learn to respond. My job is to help, no matter what they say, respond positively. That's number six. Number seven, the key to a good HR department is the relationship we have with each other. Will we have conflict? Of course we will. Will we disagree? Of course we will. But we care about each other. We'll work with each other. Number eight, the key to HR competencies are verbs, not nouns. Accelerate business, advance human capability, mobilize information, simplify complexity, and foster relationships or collaboration. And number nine, technology enables digital information for the business and for HR. And now number 10, the best is yet ahead. The best is yet ahead. You've heard it, every speaker in this conference, I've heard every speaker I hear anywhere, now is the time for HR. The opportunities for us to do those nine things, and maybe you'll add a 10th or an 11th, the best is yet ahead. I feel it a privilege to be part of your community, to learn with you and from you, to feel your passion, your energy, your inquisitiveness, for you to have those fresh insights, to take the risk, to try to make a difference. Why are we here in HR today? We're not here just to get a job. I think to some extent we're on a mission. We're on a mission to help the people we serve in the company, the people who are customers and investors, have a better experience. And when we do that, we create a virtuous spiral that the best is always yet ahead. With that, thank you. I hope you've got ideas.
Thank you very much, Dave. Can I please ask that you remain on stage? We have a very interesting segment coming up next. And this segment is where we are going into what we call candid conversations, really to explore what Dave has been sharing about, but with another perspective and with support from none other than Esther Martinez. So ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to welcome CEO and Editor-in-Chief for People Matters, Esther Martinez.
Thank you so much, Dave. And can we give it a big, big round, warm round of applause? Thank you so much, Dave. And what I love the most about today's session is he took a decision, he took a risk, and he's decided not to go with the slides, and magic happened. And I'll tell you what magic I observe. I observe each one of you listening. I observe some of you, many of you, taking handwritten notes, and research, and you love research so much. Research shows that things that we write with our own hands, I think there's either a 4 times or a 8 times, but multiple times more.
37.
37
no,
times.
I just made that up.
So, and you know, what I love the most was that none of you was taking pictures of the slides. How many of us have taken pictures of slides? And so I'll have a look at it later. How many of us have never seen those slides ever after that? Come on, come on. How many of us have not seen those slides after that? Awesome. So thank you so much, Dave, for being brave and showed us how rethinking what's possible. You decided not to go with the slides, and I think it was a gift for all of us that we were able to connect with what you were seeing.
I hope it models. I mean, we have words, fresh eyes, rethink what's possible. We teach the gospel and sometimes use words.
Correct.
And I hope that what we just did is an example of what I hope everybody... By the way, that was risky. That was scary. Because I said to Esther 2 minutes ago, should I not use any slides? And she said, why would you do that? No, she did not say that. She said, do you feel good? By the way, this is why I always feel better. She said, how do you feel about it? And I said, I think it's okay. And she said, go for it.
Awesome.
By the way, that's what good leadership is. Well done. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Wonderful. All right, so this is your time for questions to Dave. So let me see a hand up of how many questions or, you know, you may have questions, you may have dilemmas, you may have something you're struggling with. When do we have an opportunity to ask that to Dave, right? Live. And for some of you who are joining us as well virtually, please type your questions on the chat. We're going to be taking questions from all of you. So let me see a raise of hand of dilemmas, questions. We have one here. If we can get the mics rolling. More? Come on. More questions, dilemmas, perspectives that you may want. Dave's opinion, this is your chance.
By the way, as she's doing that, as you're getting them, I should have said, I hope you take some of those 10 items and go talk to people about them. Go talk to people.
Yeah.
This is not the end of the day. This is the beginning of a discussion. So that's the hope from those items. So I'll let you.
All right. So let's get the mic here. Any more challenge, dilemmas, reflections? We have one more here. Can we get the mics to reach them? And then I'm going to come this side of the room as well. Go ahead. Whoever has the mic, if you keep your hand up, the mic will reach you. Just keep your hand up.
May I borrow your pen?
Yeah, of course.
I gave away my pen.
Please, no
so I'm going to take notes.
No problem. All right. Yeah, go ahead. Would you introduce yourself as well, please?
Sure. Hi, Dave, and hi, Esther. This is Somer here. I'm part of AirAsia Super App. I head the business partner and based out of Kuala Lumpur, so I flew down from there to kind of attend this conference.
Welcome,
and especially for Dave, for you, because I think I have personally got inspired by the term for HR business partner, which you coined, right, the four roles. And I think that has shaped me for the last 11 years. And I mean, it's something for the team that I drive in, and that's the four fundamental elements in my DNA. So the thing for the HR business partner, this is something that I really want to kind of hear from you personally. What do you see? Is this going to change the four terms, right, the four roles that you kind of coined in, is this something that is going to change over the next 5 years or 10 years? Or do you think these four roles will be the role that would be sustainable for with the changing landscape of technology, the changing landscape of business, or how can we have our role better? I mean, I'm specifically saying for HR business partner role because I'm closely glued to that role. So yeah, that question, something if you can help in answering, it will be really great.
Thank you. Som, right?
Somer. Oh. Sam, you can call me Sam.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you, Samuel. Yes.
My sense is principles don't change, practices change. Let me say that again. Practices change. Early in my career, we did career assessment centers. We don't do that anymore. We did nine boxes. We may not do that. Some of you may still be doing that, but most people don't do that anymore. Those practices change. For me, the fundamental principles are fourfold. Do we have the right people? Do we have the right organization? And do you have the right leadership? Those principles, I think, will stay. Where people work, I'm going to say something anathema. They're going to hate me. I don't think hybrid's going to be a big issue in the next 5 years. We'll figure it out. Guess what? Some people are going to work at home. Some are going to be in the office. Some are going to be on airplanes and shops. Some of you are working right now, not listening to the conference, especially those virtual. It doesn't matter where you work. It matters, are you creating value from your work? That's the principle of value through talent, organization, and leadership that I believe will stay constant. That's my view. And then you say, so what's going to happen in the future? I don't know. How's that for an honest answer? Somebody asked the panelists, what's going to happen in 30 years in HR? I have no idea. I hope I'm in heaven or someplace good and there's great HR there. And then I'll come back and tell you. Anyway, those principles I think are the same. Talent, organization, leadership. That's not new. That's been around a long time.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dave. Thank you, Samuel. All right, go ahead, please.
So my name is Ratish. I come from India. What I do today is thanks to you. You're the reason why I do this job. Thank you so much for being that person. So to serve with love, thank you so much.
Thank you.
My question is, how do you learn?
How
do you learn and how do you continue to keep that alive? And I don't think we have an answer for that question through any of the written material that you have ever published in your life.
There you are.
What?
How do you learn?
My wife is a very good psychologist. And she says I have what's called OCD. Only it's organization compulsive disorder. How do I learn? I observe. I look around. I flew in last night on Singapore Airlines. I observed. Look at how incredible they were at service. They knew the names. In fact, they were almost too incredible. When I was standing up, they helped me up. And I thought, I'm not that old. I can stand up on my own. But I thought, cool it. I don't need you to help me come out of the bathroom. I can open the door and get out. But I encourage those in this room to observe. Look around. What do you see? In your family? In your work? Where you worship? Where you play? Where you learn? Just observe. I think the more that we observe, the more we can see things, and then ask yourself those curiosity questions. What did I see? Do I see that again? To be really honest, right now, I used to observe when I go to conferences. I'd sit, look at the people in the back row. They don't want you to look at them. I'd sit in the back row and observe a group. What did I see in the group? How did they interact? How did they engage? So I'd watch before I'd speak. We don't have conferences anymore, except this one, which is so good. I'm using LinkedIn as my water cooler. So if you follow me on LinkedIn, people post, I read them, I comment. I don't care who the comment's from. It's about once every 3 weeks I say, I wonder who said that. And it's somebody from India, from Pakistan. It's a senior executive. It's a first-line employee. I don't care the person. That's the beauty of technology. It's a democratic, idea-driven world. That's where I'm doing my learning right now, is kind of getting a sense. Now, some of the comments on LinkedIn are really stupid, and I'm trying to tell people that they should feel better about themselves. They're not stupid, they're just misinformed. Anyway, that's where I learned. I hope you're observing. I hope you're just curious. And then reading people. Find some, I've posted, I have 10 or 15 idea mentors. John Boudreau, I shouldn't start, Ed Lawler, C.K. Prahalad, people whose ideas are, in India, C.K., their ideas, T.V. Rao, their ideas are so incredible. I follow them and learn. Okay, that's a personal answer.
Thank you so much, Dave.
Oh, I'm going to keep this until he's done.
All right, so we have one hand there and one more hand here. And oh my God, see, now where is your warming up?
Four more.
We're warming up here. So we can get the mics. Can you keep your hand up? Then we'll get the mics to join.
Esther, how do you learn?
How do I learn?
While the mic's going.
I love to solve problems. If I see a problem, I go for it because that's my learning way. I problem solve, and that's my.
So my challenge to anyone who works with Esther, bring her a difficult problem. Bring her the most obscene problem that ever existed. No, I'm sorry.
I love problems. I think problems are just gifts.
I agree.
For me to learn.
By the way, that's what I love is tell me the challenge you don't have a solution to.
Yeah.
If you've got a solution, I can't help. But, yeah. And then I lift stuff. I was doing coaching for an executive, and you probably heard of him. He's passed away. Brilliant executive named Jack Welch at General Electric. And he said, Dave, I demand that my leaders practice participative management.
I demand.
And I said, say that again. I demand that they participate. You're not that stupid. You can't demand what you're not modeling. And he said, oh, I guess that's right. And he said, what do I do? I said, don't do that. Don't ever say that. Don't demand what you don't model. Yeah. I mean, that's the kind of learning. If you just put your eyes open, you'll see those things. And I think they're fun. Okay.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Mike, who has the mic? Yeah, go ahead. Please introduce yourself.
Good afternoon. I'm Jocelyn Morales from Philippines. So I am with Philippine HR Group, one of the largest group in Philippines. So here's my questions. A lot of my team members are not sure if HR is for them. How do I help them to decide that HR is a vocation? Thank you,
that
sir.
That HR is?
A vocation.
A vocation. So you want Dave's opinion on how HR is a good option for people who may want to get into HR?
Yes, yes. All right.
So it's people that want to get into
HR? People who are not yet in HR, how do we...
Good. Look at my second point. HR is not about HR. Don't go to someone and say, hi, I'm from HR, I'm here to help. That's not helpful at all. I think you go to somebody and say, what are you struggling with? What are the problems you're trying to solve as a business leader? Is it customer service? Is it economic, financial success? Is it market value? Is it innovation pipeline? Let me understand your problems, and then let me show you how HR will help you. I'm not here giving you a solution. I'm here to co-create for you what will help you reach your goals. I think that value is defined by the receiver becomes so critical. When I meet with business leaders, I don't want them to know I'm from HR. I want them to know I'm a business. I saw a picture the other day of three brilliant HR executives. All happen to be female, all happen to be minorities. And somebody said, what do you see in that picture? I think this was on LinkedIn. And here was my comment. Three great business leaders. I don't see gender, I don't see race, I don't see function. I see three great business leaders. I hope that's what we do is we build credibility. Yeah. We create value for them.
Yeah. Wonderful. Big round of applause for that. Three business leaders. And I've never heard that comment about function as a way to silo, whether it's HR or any other function, but it's also a way to silo.
Yep.
In a beautiful way. All right, more. We have time for maybe two, three more questions. So let me have one here. Who has the mic? To the gentleman, and then we'll have two more, four. Is everyone okay with that compromise? All right, let's go ahead. And we have a lady at the very back, and we want to hear the back benchers as well. Yeah, go ahead, please.
Hi, Dave. Hi, Esther. My name is Bridget from Ascendia. First of all, I'm a fan of you, Dave. I have many of books, and I've been using your HR model for my past 20 years in my HR professional.
Wonderful.
So really, thank you. Just now you have shared with us, like the 10 commandments. And one of the points that you have raised is the job of a leader is to make the others feel better,
yeah.
Right? I wonder, in your profession,
we have you?
I wonder, you know, as a HR, how do we teach our leader to behave in such a way that they can make their subordinate or their staff feel better after a session of performance appraisal?
Yeah. There is a lot of pain in that question, no?
It's, like, it's a difficult one.
You know, this is all fine, but how do we really do it after...
Well, look at the example I gave, the gentleman I was coaching.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question. And thank you for the kind comment. I was in China once and they were making kind comments and I said, you need to send these to my mother. And I put her email up and my mother talked to me the next day and said, never do that again. So anyway, the example I gave, an employee made a mistake, bad mistake. Sometimes in HR, we're not willing to say, you got to talk about the mistake. You can't walk away from that accountability. But notice the lines. I care about you. You have great potential. You made a mistake. It's painful. What did you learn? And I think in a performance appraisal, the line I've used is, how do you make performance appraisal a positive experience? How do you leave that appraisal feeling better, even when it's negative? And if it's negative, it's negative. You can't hide from the raw data. So that's I care about you. You have great potential. What are you learning? And then the leader to say, I'm going to learn with you, and to own their mistakes. By the way, anyone, how many have ever in a relationship they've been in had a difference of opinion with a partner you love and care about? Okay, some of you have never had a partner. You know what? You work through it. You work through it, even after years. I care about you. We've got a little conflict here. Let's talk it through. What's going on? And I think we can coach leaders to do that accountability in a very positive way without avoiding the accountability, because that's a piece of it. I'm going to ask a question.
Yes.
You've invested so much in this conference with your team, and we're grateful. What do you hope people leave here with?
Yes, Dave always does this with me. I'm the one who asks the questions, but he always turns them around. So I would say at three levels. At the more superficial level, I think an opportunity to get out of your to-dos, your daily work. I think at the very superficial level, just to take you out of that would be the number one objective, whether you're joining us virtually or you're joining us physically. The number two objective will be the usual, you know, learning, opportunity to meet, and so on and so forth. But at the fundamental level, what we will love the conference to create is a little spark of courage, energy, something that it's difficult to measure, but something that makes you being different. There is a before and there's an after. And if you're able to bring a spark of pride, energy, and boldness, so when you join back on Monday office, you see your problems with a different energy, a different optimism.
Or with fresh eyes.
Or with a fresh eye.
Or imagine the possible.
I think that will be a successful conference to us.
Nice. Thank you. Thank you. Well done.
Thank you. And don't put me on the spot. I'm the one asking the questions now. So I command you to answer the questions.
I feel better about myself.
Okay, who has the mic? You were first. Again, go ahead, please. And I'm going to come to the back. The mic is there? Okay, all right. So I'll come to you in a minute. Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Justin from Thinking Machines in the Philippines.
Yes, Justin.
I think this is more of like a, also coming from a very personal place and something I've been thinking about, and I think this conference kind of like puts it in the forefront for me. I think this might be a generalization, but I feel like a lot of people here in the HR industry gets attracted to the HR role at some level because they want to care about people, they want to help people around them, stuff like that. And I think people start their journeys towards from that place. But I think as you take more time or spend more time in the role, spend more time in the industry, and really get to know the industry, you get more and more realization towards sort of number two, what David mentioned, which is HR is not really about HR. It's about the business. And I guess I want to get your thoughts, maybe some wisdom or tips on how one may reconcile this potential disconnect where maybe they're not as motivated by the bottom line, but obviously that's the reality of where we are. How do we find the motivation? How do we find, I guess, that spark?
I gave you 10 lines. I'll give an 11th. Take care of yourself so that you can care for others. HR is in a tough job right now. We're the caregivers, the emotional energy in companies. If you can't take care of yourself, it's going to be hard for you to care for others. So the takeaway for me from your comment is, are we taking care of ourselves? Physically, emotionally, socially, spiritually, intellectually, are we taking care of ourselves so that we can then care for others? Steve Covey calls it an emotional bank account. I hope we take care, and that's what this conference does. It's renewing. That was your all three. Get out of the to-dos, care for yourself, learn, fresh eyes. I hope we care for ourselves so that we model that in others.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your question. I'm coming to the back, and I have all the time, but Dave has a very tight schedule, so you have to tell me what's our heart.
I can do one more question.
One more question? All right, I'm going to come to the back, and you make it count, because this is the last question. All right, so a lot of responsibility.
Yeah, I wouldn't leave the conference without asking this question to David anyway. But Dave, this is Joan, and I'm from the Philippines. My question is,
would you introduce yourself? I'm really sorry, I didn't get your name.
Yeah, my name is Joan.
It's Joan.
Like Joan of Arc.
Go ahead, Joan.
Yes, thank you. My question is, how do we reposition ourselves in terms of partnering strategically with business if the business leaders only see HR as transactional or people who only help execute their decision?
All right, so there is also a lot of pain in that comment or question.
Yeah, a lot of pain.
How do we really make it,
you know,
that partnership?
I'm gonna
it takes two hands to clap, right? Yep. So how
20, do we 60, 20. Distribution. 20% of business leaders are phenomenal. They understand human capability. They're doing it. They're modeling it. My advice to us in HR is get out of their way. Don't claim that we made it so. 20% may never get there. For whatever reason, they just won't get there. Here's my advice. Move on. I just... Sometimes it's going to take, by the way, focus on the 60%. And then the answers are the things we talked about. What's in it for you? How will this help you? How will you reach your goals by my supporting you through HR? But if you've got one of those leaders who that bottom and you say it's not 20%, it's 15, nobody's arguing that. There's some leaders. How many of us have ever worked for one of those leaders? Good. I hope you moved on. because you just, there's... I have tried to coach some of those leaders. Final anecdote. I got called in to coach. I go into a room. It's a family company that's publicly traded. The son is wanting to move up. And I said, what can I do? And he said, coach me. And I said, why? And he said, I have to be coached so that I can get promoted. Why do you want to get coached? So I can be promoted. Is there anything you're thinking about? No, just... Tell me what I should do. Tell me that you've coached me, and then we'll move on. By the way, it was less than 5 minutes. I flew a long way for a 5 minute. I opened the door. The HR person was still standing there, and he shook his head, and he said, I bet that didn't go very well. And I said, no. Move on. Yeah. If you've got those leaders, by the way, move on smart. I had another person who quit without a job. And couldn't find a job. So don't be, that's Pet Cam's common sense. Don't, anyway. I'm finding fewer of those leaders because I think in the last 2 years, HR is now center stage. Context is the kingdom. The context of the world is putting HR center stage. May we rise to that opportunity with fresh eyes, with thinking the impossible, May we rise to the opportunity. That's my final comment and plea. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. And we couldn't think of a better way to close the conference than with Dave Ulrich spending time with us all the way here in Singapore. A big round of applause once again, Professor Dave Ulrich. Thank you so much for being with us. And I'm going to invite you to be here with me. We're going to do another experiment. So are you guys ready for some fun? It will just take 5 minutes, but I'm going to need everyone in the room to participate. So are you in for some fun? All right. So we're going to do this together. And Dave, you have no clue what I'm going to do right now, but you will do it with me. You're okay?
Yes? Absolutely.
All right. Okay, step number one we're going to do is, if you have a paper that you've used to take notes, fold it and keep it safely. Whatever you were using, just keep it safely. Because we were giving you some papers for some other activity, but Dave asked me, can I request the group to use a paper? I said yes, but I want to make sure that whatever you use that paper for, we keep it safely. Yeah? All saved? All right, so all of you will have some papers with you, extra papers, maybe one or two. If you don't have papers, just raise your hand. You need to have at least one, ideally two or three. But if you have one, that's enough. If you don't have a paper, you can raise your hand. And we will need one for me and for Dave, if possible. But I can see everyone has a paper, right? Okay, great. So now we're going to stand up. We're going to stand up. If you're comfortable.
Yep.
And you can leave your, you need hands free. So free hands, right? And if we can have a paper for me and Dave as well. Thank you so much. All right, so thank you. All right, so can I see your paper? All right, good. So that was step number one, all of these things. All right, so what we're going to do now is, in the morning we started with the video that invited us to imbibe some child-like behavior, to remember when we were children, how we saw things with fresh eyes and how we were able to, there was no past, there was no future, there was only present, and there were some of the words we shared with you in the morning. And we're going to do this exercise together to kind of just bring some of that fun and some of those memories. So step one, now, step one of the real activity is going to be, if you have a paper, just make a ball out of it. If you have more than one, make one, two, three. One ball per paper. One paper, make a ball out of each paper. And you kind of know where I'm going with this, I think. Some of you may know where I'm going with you with this. Now you have, can I see all your weapons of mass destruction? So now I'm going to invite you to go and find a target and not Dave and I. So please turn around and just find a target, or maybe several targets. Just keep an eye.
Oh.
Not yet. Just find a target, but don't shoot. We will do it all together. Follow my instructions carefully. So just find a target, and at the count of three, not before, at the count of three, we will all just have some fun. Are we ready? You found your target? Yes? Okay. So one, two, three, go!
Put your hands up in the air. 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 Put your hands up in the air.
Awesome. Thank you. And now?
Put your hands up in the
now,
air.
Now the most important step. The most important step, which is step three, can I invite you to go and pick up your paper? Everyone, and if I can request Ritu to take two papers, one for Dave and one for me on behalf. Everyone, if you threw one paper, pick up one. If you threw three, thank you so much. And I'm gonna invite you to keep this paper and save it, and maybe just remember that this is just an opportunity to have some fun, to reconnect, but also the responsibility that we have to make sure that we leave this venue as it was before we came. So thank you once again. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for making People Matters Take HR 2022 a grand success. And we will see you very, very soon
Intake HR 2023. Thank you so much and enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you.